In March 1940, an area of land in the parish of Pollington, 7 miles southwest of Goole in East Yorkshire, was surveyed in preparation for a new airfield for Bomber Command, the construction of which commenced later in the same year. It was built to the usual standard, having 3 intersecting concrete runways, with the main, 139, at 1400 yards, and the 2 subsidiaries, 231 and 093, at 1100 yards each. These were extended to 2000 and 1400 yards, leaving 093 at 1100 yards. An encircling concrete perimeter track was laid, off which were constructed 36 pan-type hardstandings. Snaith was furnished with the watch office with met section to plans 51840 and 893640. And for hangars, it was equipped with 1 Type J and 2 Type T2s, which were all constructed on the technical site of temporary buildings immediately to the south of the flying field. The bomb stores, a series of blast mound protected revetments, lay in fields to the west on the opposite side of the airfield from the main technical site. The camp was built to house a population of 168 officers and 1,852 other ranks, plus 8 WAF officers and 386 WAFs. This was constructed to the southeast. RAF Snaith was allotted the Pundit Code of SX and provided with a decoy airfield at nearby Drax. RAF Snaith opened into No. 1 Group Bomber Command on the 1st of July 1941, and although adjacent to the near village of Pollington, for operational and safety reasons it was decided that Snaith would be the name of the station. The fear was that the name Pollington was too close to Pocklington, another bomber station in the group, which lay near to York, and confusion from this could result. On the 10th, No. 150 Squadron arrived from RAF Newton with Wellington 1Cs to begin operations as part of No. 1 Group Main Force. No. 150 Squadron was to receive Wellington 3s in September 1942 before being moved to Kirmington in October. During its time at Snaith, No. 150 had lost 57 Wellingtons and 205 airmen killed in operations. RAF Snaith was then transferred to No. 4 Group Bomber Command, and No. 51 Squadron arrived from Chivenor on the 27th of October, having been on loan to Coastal Command. They had flown more sorties in Whitley than any other squadron by the time they arrived at Snaith. As soon as they arrived, they began to replace their obsolete Whitley 5s with Halifax 2s and began training and working up with the new aircraft. When once again declared operational, No. 51 Squadron, for the remainder of the war, became part of No. 4 Group's main force based at Snaith, and suffered the usual heavy losses from an RAF bomber station. ...1943 arrived, and on the 13th of February at approximately 17:30, with the aircraft bombed up ready for a mission against Lorient, blue smoke was observed coming from the bomb bay of Halifax DH-722. The bomb aimer re-entered the aircraft to rescue the 2 pigeons and shouted to everyone to take cover since an explosion was likely, which shortly followed. At approximately 1800 on the other side of the airfield, Halifax DT-724's bomb aimer was checking his equipment on the aircraft. On connecting the batteries for a test, a bunch of incendiaries fell onto the hard standing through the open bomb doors and ignited immediately. All the crew ran and threw themselves into the nearest dugout. One of the high explosive bombs exploded, scattering the remainder of the load onto the airfield. The tail unit from the bomb went through the roof onto an unoccupied bunk in one of the barrack huts, and a large hole was blasted into the dispersal. The squadron's operations were cancelled for the night and the aircraft investigated. The aircraft concerned were newly arrived and were fitted with American-made bomb controls, which were found to contain drilling swarf from the manufacturing process. The effect of this swarf was to produce a short circuit in the selector unit, so that when set to safe, it released the bombs prematurely. The above explosion was followed on the 19th of June, when a huge explosion occurred in the Snaith bomb dump area. The clearing up of the site took about a month, and a number of armourers were mentioned in dispatches. The bomb dump itself was redesigned. 1944 arrived, and in January No. 51 Squadron began to receive Halifax 3s. On the night of the 13th and 14th of January, Halifax 3, MZ465Y for Yorker, having completed the raid on Saarbrücken, collided with a Halifax from RAF Elvington in mid-air. The Elvington Halifax lost its tail and dived into the ground out of control and exploded. Some 9 feet of the nose of Y for Yorker was sheared off, and the navigator and the bomb aimer, neither of whom were wearing parachutes, fell from the aircraft. With some of the skin of the aircraft's nose bent round, giving a small protection against the wind at 7,000 feet, Flying Officer Andrew Wilson somehow managed to bring the aircraft back to base with only three of its flying instruments still working, and is said to have made a perfect landing. Bomber Harris sent a memo regarding this feat which read, "This officer undoubtedly showed a very high standard of pilotage and captaincy in bringing his aircraft back to a base in the United Kingdom in its crippled condition. By his coolness and sound airmanship in adverse conditions, he saved the lives of the remainder of his crew." Flying Officer Wilson was awarded the Air Force Cross for an act of exemplary gallantry while flying. The clock turned to 1945, and on the 14th of January, Sea Flight was detached to form the core of No. 578 Squadron, which, after flying a few operations, moved to Bern on the 5th of February. No. 51 Squadron slogged on and flew its last operational mission to bomb Wangaruga Island on the 25th of April. Two days later, No. 266 Squadron with Typhoons arrived from Needs Oil Point for a smoke-laying exercise. Then on the 29th, No. 51 Squadron finally departed Snaith from Lickenfield to become part of No. 7 Group Transport Command. During operations from Snaith, No. 51 had flown 264 missions, lost 148 aircraft, and 687 airmen had died. No. 266 Squadron moved back to Needs Oil Point on the 6th of May, and this effectively finished RAF Snaith as an operational airfield. On the 1st of September, No. 1516 Beam Approach Training Flight arrived from Odium with Oxfords and was rapidly renamed as No. 1516 Radio AIDS Training Flight. On the 20th of the month, No. 1508 Radio AIDS Training Flight was reformed at Snaith with Oxfords. They too were renamed and became No. 1508 Acclimatisation Flight. 1946 was to be the final chapter for RAF Snaith. No. 1508 Acclimatisation Flight was disbanded on the 1st of April, followed 10 days later by No. 1516 Radio AIDS Training Flight, and the airfield was closed and placed on care and maintenance. A total of 205 aircraft had been lost from RAF Snaith. The unwanted airfield rapidly reverted to agriculture. Some buildings still remain, but most of the runways are torn up to provide building materials for the M62 motorway that was constructed across the top third of the airfield during the 1970s. The Pollington Airfield Memorial Garden was created on the site of the former station headquarters as a living memorial to those who served at RAF Snaith. The inscription on the memorial stone reads, "In memory of the 687 airmen of 51 Squadron 4 Group Bomber Command, who lost their lives flying Halifax bombers, Marks 2 and 3 here at RAF Snaith between October 1942 and April 1945. It also remembers the 205 airmen of 150 Squadron lost on active duty who preceded them at this airfield, flying Wellington bombers Marks 1 and 3.